The good ship Carrick, an old and rickety but ever trustworthy coaster, forging a passage to Wisbech.
Dirty British coaster with a salt-caked smokestack, butting through the channel in the mad March days with a cargo of time coal, road rail, pig lead, firewood, ironware, and cheap tin trays.
The cargoes have changed. The job goes on. The Carrick is a direct descendant of the coaster of John Masefield's poem. Built 31 years ago, she's one of the oldest British coasters still afloat and working.
Mass entrance, Carrick, Carrick.
Carrick, mass entrance.
Good afternoon, sir. Just leaving your report. I'd like to go away to the southwest when I can.
Okay.
Thank you. Coasting is carrying cargoes around the British coast and across to the near continent, essentially. As far as I know, it's probably one of the oldest trades in the world. But it's something that's been going on in small craft, big craft, since the year dot.
Carrick's skipper, Rick Waters, is also her owner. He and his wife run a small fleet of three ships, all old, all tramping the ports and busy waters of the North Sea and English Channel. It's a restless life, of strange rhythms and uncertain hours, of slow routine and sudden incident.
This is a risk business, a high risk business. You're all on your own. If you don't know anything about the business, you're entirely at the mercy of anyone, and there's plenty of maritime horse traders about, for want of a better word. There are plenty of honest people. But you've got to know about the job to find them.
How's your head now, Deli?
Okay.
Okay. What are you steering?
272.
272. When I ask you how your head is, you give me what the ship is steering at that moment. Okay?
Carrick carries a regular crew of five, plus at the moment a trainee.
You ought to course to starboard to 280.
280.
The mate, George Norman, sharing with the skipper the navigation of the ship, a seaman all his life. The trainee, Deli Okukenu, in his first job at sea. Victor Gould, deckhand, came to coasters from fishing. His home port is Macduff by Inverness. Alan Jopling, former mate on deep sea trawlers until the fishing died. His trawler mate's ticket is no good for coasters, so he works as a deckhand.
The hours can be long. They can be tiring, because if you're doing a sea passage, then you get to the port and you're told you're loading on arrival, then you have to work through the loading hours. Then maybe it's your turn for the watch going back across the other side.
Tom Owen, the ship's engineer. Recently married, he's new to the company, and still learning the curious ways of Carrick's old Dutch diesel engine.
Unfortunately, the company has been dogged slightly with mishaps with this engine. You get the odd trip where all you do is start it and oil it and grease it and forget about it, and other trips where you're up every hour the cob made. So one counteracts the others, but basically it's quite a long day.
Long days, but steady progress. Driving along at a stately 8 knots through some of the most crowded and dangerous sea lanes in the world, chasing cargoes, chasing tides.
Coasters are coasters. They're made to round headlands quite closely, closely but safely. This is part and parcel of coasting. If we can see a shortcut, we take a shortcut, particularly if we're in a hurry to meet a tide. A half an hour on a passage can be a question of working cargo that day or not working cargo that day. If you don't work cargo that day, That's another day's wages the ship has lost.
Past Beachy Head, bound for Exmouth out of Rotterdam with a cargo of fertilizer, the ship's course leads west towards the Isle of Wight. With bad weather expected, the captain decides to take the ship through the Solent, in the shelter of the island. In all, it's a two-day passage, long enough to establish a routine of watchkeeping, a rare regularity in a most irregular life.
I think people find the independence of the job attractive. You're not working set hours, you're not clock-watching all the time, you're not thinking, when 12 o'clock comes, we'll have the factory hooter and we can all dash off to the canteen for the chip butties. You're always working to something, but you're not actually working to the clock. Although, perhaps in some ways, you're more covered by the clock because of time and tide. This sort of life, we're all on first-name terms. And you don't get respect through the rank. It's no good hiding behind a uniform all the time and saluting. People will soon spot a phony, and they won't work for it.
The wind drops away, and by morning, only a swell is left.
I went to sea as a young lad on a local company in the Channel Islands. I then joined the Shipping Federation at King George V Dock, London. Albeit 4 months or a year, you'd come back, sign off, have your leave, and then report back to the Federation for further employment. I spent 15 years on Federated ships. I was forced to take voluntary redundancy 2 years ago. There just weren't the ships around. The Merchant Navy has contracted to a terrifying degree these days. So I stepped from Federated ships to this company. When I first arrived on this ship 2 years ago, coming from the Federation, I found it strange. It was strange to get used to the informality, having been used to the formal side of the Merchant Navy. On a ship this size, we tend not to operate any demarcation. And the mate's job is not only to oversee these duties, but to muck in as well. At the end of the day, we're in business, and our business is to get a cargo from A to B in the shortest time possible and as efficiently as we can manage it.
A mile off Exmouth, the pilot comes aboard. He must guide the ship safely into harbour through the narrow, shifting channels. It's a question of his local knowledge. If a ship goes aground, access may be blocked, the port's work halted.
Good morning, Jack. How are you? What a bad night, eh?
I'm doing slow at the moment.
Going full speed when you're ready then, please. You come down inside the island?
Couldn't have timed it better. I say, if we'd have been half an hour earlier, we'd have anchored, we wouldn't be here now.
No, that's right.
Pretty amazing.
It did go through very quick, didn't it?
It did. In fact, it went through for us while we were going through the Solent.
Did it?
Yeah.
We should keep her fairly well off this jetty, and then let her drop in with the wind.
This is the one that's collapsed, isn't
it? That's correct. High speed, please, sir.
High speed. I love this run in here. I think it's special.
Check on the spring.
Check her, George!
Aye, aye. Slow speed.
Exmouth is like most British coastal ports. It's only accessible at certain states of the tide. It's small and private, outside the National Dock Labour Scheme. The equipment is mostly primitive, bucket and shovel, as opposed to the high-tech automation of the continental superports. But it's competitive and it's convivial, and with a pub on the quay, it offers a chance of an evening away from the ship's confining spaces.
What time they're starting?
You are going to turn up tomorrow?
Yeah, 7 o'clock.
Oh, right.
Can I have a vodka, please? I'm going to have a double bottle for a man. Hello, Miss Dilly. This chap came aboard from the Cascade, right?
Oh, yeah.
About the timber.
Oh, yeah.
We settled a deal.
Okay. So how much have you... Have you bought the whole lot?
No, I said as much as we want. Oh, yeah. 50 pence a metre. People ask me, well, how do you get cargoes for the ship? I mean, do you bring up people? Like in the old days, do you go around all the agents in one port and try and find a cargo when you're finished discharging? Well, it's not quite like that anymore. Now we have chartering agents who do the job for us.
Good morning, Rick Waters for chartering.
Hi, Tim.
How are you? Oh, not bad.
Well, we should be finished about 11 o'clock, I think. By the time the pilot gets his bum in gear, I suppose we'll be away about noon. Tim Pompey, about midnight tonight.
Carrick's agents in Great Yarmouth work the ship on the spot market. It's a game of chance, waiting to the last minute to book the next cargo, trading the risk of finding no work against the higher cargo rates for late arrangements.
The spot market is just what it means. You can discharge a cargo and have nothing to carry. You have no orders and perhaps not the possibility of any for a day, maybe 2 days, when your chartering agent will receive a telex from somebody who needs to load a cargo the next day, and you're on the spot. You are put in for it, you are accepted.
Accepted, that is, subject to a hold inspection. The next cargo in Portsmouth will be grain. Before loading can start, any trace of the fertilizer must be swept and washed away. And damage to the hold's timber floor must be repaired. This floor, strangely called the ceiling, is a constant concern.
The ceiling now tends to be a little bit like a patchwork quilt. So we do have one or two problems in maintaining it, particularly after a bobcat discharge. If the driver's not very careful, he tends to rip the ceiling off.
There's this coaster that's being cut up. I've been in contact with the chap over the last 2 weeks, and I went out there Saturday afternoon, and he's got a load of timber that he wants to get rid of. Obviously, it's no good to him out there, unless he wants to build a paddy raft or something. And it would be ideal if we could get hold of it, but it means laying out several hundred quid in cash. Oh. Well, after it's been in for a couple of trips, it won't have any difference
or anything else. Old coasters rarely die. Assaulted by scavengers and cannibals, their parts take on a new existence, re-enlisted in the battle to keep cargoes moving. A battle in which beauty must be sacrificed to business.
We tend to laugh it off and talk amongst ourselves of being on an old rust bucket. But at the end of the day, when we have the paint, we do set out to make the ship appear as attractive as we can.
I resent the term rust bucket used of our ships. Essentially, they are not rust buckets. They just show signs of their age. They are like old ladies. You must help them across the road from time to time. But basically, they can stand on their own 2 feet.
Out of Exmouth, in ballast, bound for Portsmouth. For the trainee, Deli Okokenu, it's the last trip before a fortnight's leave and a month's study at the sea training school. It's his first real break since he joined the ship 8 months ago.
Well, originally I wanted to go deep sea, but because of the recession, there's not many jobs going in that area. So this was second choice. I think I was a bit disillusioned. I didn't really think ships like this were around that much, but it's worth it for the job.
Steer 110.
I'm a bit iffy about staying on at the moment. Don't know if I still want to make a career out of it or not. It'd be better than being something like a truck driver, I reckon. I've proved to myself that I'm capable of doing the job, I think. But I'm still a bit careless in some ways. A bit clumsy in some ways. But on the whole, I'd say I've coped fairly well with that. I miss a lot of things on land, no relations and no land life in general. But on the other hand, if I went ashore, I'd miss this. Getting around a bit. There's two very different lifestyles. I want a bit of both.
Portsmouth, and rain stops play. It may also stop pay.
On this ship, we're paid a salary. On top of this salary, we're paid a cargo bonus. The more cargoes we do, the more we earn. Once we start working a grain cargo, any rain whatsoever, we have to close the holds. The load may take 3 or 4 days, depending on the weather. We may lose our next cargo. If we lose the next cargo, we lose the cargo bonus.
Come on, George. The bloke said the hatch was wet.
A little bit damp.
Yeah.
Did he say
we can't pull?
Well, out. No, I know you can't, but yeah. I thought it was a bit.
Did he say we couldn't load?
No.
No,
he didn't say that.
No,
to
he
me.
Didn't say that.
No, he said no. He told me he was quite
he
happy.
He said you it would be ready by 7 o'clock in the morning.
Certainly it will. Yeah. Yes.
Well, I mean, we could load this afternoon if we really
without
want.
Without a shadow of a doubt, we're ready to load.
I mean, if it's a question of time being signed on or sign being signed off,
we're not.
We really got to know this now, not tomorrow morning.
So you're not going to start now, are we?
No, but
well,
we are ready.
7 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah. That's right, yeah.
Right. 7 o'clock in the morning, it will be wide open.
We're enjoying it.
They've made a cods with a bloody cubic capacity on the
body,
whatever
you want to call it.
It's going in at 52 instead of about 54. So we'd be down by the head if we stayed as we were loading forward. So they're going to load aft, and it's going to be in a V-shape when it's finished. So they'll be bagging
in the middle.
That way and that way. So it'll be a V-shape, as I say.
Yeah.
Quite a deal of care has to be taken loading the cargo. If you don't keep a careful eye on the situation, particularly in a cargo of grain, they may load it on one side of the vessel will lay over and the grain will run on that side. So you start off with a very small list and you can end with a very large list. Grain is a particularly hazard cargo. We regard grain as being a liquid. It does tend to shift. Shifting can cause the capsize of the vessel if the cargo shifts in a heavy beam sea.
I'm going to take a pint of beer out of douchey.
To prevent shifting, part of the cargo is bagged and used to stabilize the rest. It's a primitive but effective precaution against one of the sea's greatest dangers.
There are so many things to consider before a ship goes to sea. You have to consider the the cargo, whether that's safely stowed. You have to consider whether the hatches are properly battened down. You have to consider whether the crew are ready to go to sea. They may have been working 24 hours and everybody's due for a break.
What was the commander looks like? Plenty of spaghetti bolognese, Victor. Yeah?
If the skipper is the owner, he has an extra consideration.
Why don't you just take the bread out and leave the tray off the top?
Basically, if he's a good owner, it shouldn't conflict with the judgment that he would make anyway.
Five out of six cylinders cough into life. The sixth is blanked off, temporarily out of order. One of the ship's three generators is also packed up. The autopilot throws occasional fits, so it's back to steering by hand.
A bit more than 200 or so.
The destination, in Belgium, is 36 hours away.
QHM, Carrick, just leaving the, well, I suppose you'd call it the narrow channel, whatever.
Carrick, QHM, roger, we have the large commercial vessel, the Clipper, harbour entrance, inward bound from Johnson, over.
Thank you, sir, I'll keep an eye out for him. No doubt he'll do the same for me. Thank you.
I've always liked engines. Machinery will fascinate me. I think about the age of four, I helped various people or hindered them pulling their cars apart. I spent 12 years in the Royal Navy and left there, came to sea on the coast. This is my third or fourth ship on the coast. I think not so much the general public, but other merchant servicemen generally think of coaster crews as being one of the lowest of the low, the scum of the earth and what have you. Why, I don't know, because I think we've got a greater responsibility than them and we do a lot more hours than them. There's just something between the big ship and the little ship. They don't like us and we're not over keen on them.
You have the bilge pump going or something, that's why. Holocaust of water going over the side.
Yes. And I use a bilge pump for emergency cooling.
Ah.
From the North Sea, and here's one for all those who go down to the sea in ships. Petula Clark, and hello!
I learned to cook, well, I watch other people, copy off them. The Yorkshire pudding, I did have a disaster. And notice any cake tray, whatever you call it, and it didn't rise. So I turned it upside down and made it rise the other way, but it wouldn't do. I've been with this ship for about 3 years on and off. And to me, well, I doubt my mother would approve, but it's my second home, it is. I love this ship. I couldn't have a normal girlfriend on here because you wouldn't see a lot of her. There's no guarantee you'd go to the same place trip after trip or every other trip, whatever. So I wouldn't have a normal girlfriend, well, a steady girlfriend.
Is Alan about, isn't he?
Yeah. He came down to see if I needed a hand.
Ah, good lad, though. So I saw him get the paint out, the paintbrush.
As she sailed across the sea, oh, my love is there beside you. In Capri or Amsterdam, Honolulu or Siam, to the harbour of my heart.
You have to do everything as a deckhand. The working of the hatches, I do watches, cooking. There's always something different. I could never work ashore, because I've tried that before. And I don't like to be confined in spaces. like to be out in the open.
How were the temperatures when you got down there?
Warm.
In the 80s. 80s. Plenty of steam and things.
Too much steam. A pipe in the cooling system ruptures. The engine overheats. Everything shuts down. Carrick drifts quietly an hour off the Belgian coast. There's nothing to do but wait.
Well, I went to Rye Grammar School, and we had a promotional film about life at sea as an apprentice. And sailed around the world, and they played football here, cricket there, hockey somewhere else. And they had lessons on board, and they wrote letters home, sitting atop grassy hillocks overlooking blue lagoons with a ship in the middle at a lovely anchorage. And I thought, goodness gracious me, I thought, this is the life for me. And I wondered that nobody else joined me in the rush for the handouts afterwards. I emphasised, I remember well, my sporting attributes, thinking it's what they wanted. I told them I got my school colours for football. I was house cricket captain, I think. I even went putting in case they wanted me to play golf for the ship as well. Duly ended up with a small tramship company. And passed the interview there. But no cricket, no football, no sport. It was all work. I went away to sea and did my 4-year apprenticeship with them and got my second mate's ticket.
The repairs go on, and with evening approaching, the drift must be stopped.
Owning 3 ships isn't actually piece of cake, but it gives you a different feeling because you are involved with 3 times as many men as you are on one ship. And if things go well, you can also make some money, which I suppose is the basic reason why we have the capitalist system, why I endorse it, why I'm part of it, and why I strive to make it work.
First problem solved. After 3 hours, the generator and the cooling pump revive. Second problem solved, and at last the main engine restarts. As a capitalist, Rick Waters is not a spectacular success, despite a spell as part-time butler to Edward Heath. 2 years ago, the company nearly went bust, and even now, like its ships, it needs the occasional helping hand. For the crew, basic wages are not high, about £85 a week for a deckhand, £150 for a mate. But board and lodging are included, and cargo bonuses can add another £2,000 or more a year. It's better than average pay for coasters, and this is a happy company.
I woke up
to a chump, chump, chump.
Good monkeys, boy.
I really did think, what on earth was happening? So I got up to sort of assess the situation.
Don't panic.
And what had happened is that this particular man had drunk so much alcohol and he'd wanted to talk to the sailor next door and he couldn't get in. So he acquired the fire axe and started chopping the door down to get in to see this particular sailor, which worried this particular sailor at the time. But, the sequel to this story was I'd made a cup of coffee and I'd placed it on the mess room table and I was there with this man and he dunked his penis in this cup of coffee, which I thought must have been quite exquisite.
Have you got any teaspoons on there?
From Antwerp, after discharge, to a canal side in Holland for the sixth cargo of the month. It'll be a good month for bonuses. There's a brisk wind and the threat of gales. The one-ton bags, potatoes for a chip factory, are awkward to stow safely.
Oh! Lay them over. Push them over. Get another one in on the top.
Push them over now.
Too much room.
Push them over.
They're over again, Gordon. Hold on.
Over now, pull them down.
Did you see it?
Yeah, I saw that, yeah. You know,
I really can't see why you couldn't have got those a bit tighter before, really. Look around here. Look at that down there. Look. Well, of course, what happens then when the ship goes to sea and rolls? All these potatoes go either one side or the other. These words have to be filled.
Well,
filled.
Yeah,
right.
Right.
So what's the answer then, Paul?
Yeah. No, do you want that here?
Certainly I do. Well, I cannot. Well, I certainly want it better than this.
Three
hours
there and three if
you
know
what
you're
talking about. That fucking stone potato, is it? You're going to take your ship to sea like that or what? Eh?
You get stresses on a ship through the weather, through the working of the waves, the ship moving about. You get the stress on the crew. If you're rolling about in a heavy sea, you've got to look after yourself all the time. It's a strain. You're bracing against everything, every movement. You can't cook properly, so you start going without food. You become exhausted, and it's then you get problems. Situations arise you can't deal with. You suddenly find you're on the lee shore and the engine keeps breaking down. Well, it's been happening on and off for 2 days now. He's fixed it before. He'll fix it again. And all of a sudden, you find you're a mile off the beach. The wind's blowing you on. And Christ, he hasn't fixed it again. They have an inquiry because there's been loss of life. And the inquiry is carried out in a courtroom where everybody's been having a full night's sleep. They're getting regular meals. And they just cannot understand why so-and-so did what he did. And probably they're not seamen anyway, so there's no way how they could understand why he did what he did.
The Union Star, lost with all hands off the Cornish coast in 1981, was just one of more than 30 coasters come to grief in the last 10 years. Such catastrophes, together with the routine hazards of the job, wet and rolling decks, cramped working spaces, sharp edges, give it one of the highest accident rates of any industry. And as an industry, coasting is changing, declining in numbers of ships, but holding its own in terms of tonnage carried. The old ship-shaped coasters are being replaced by expensive barge-like boxers carrying more cargo. The likes of Carrick pass to owner skippers, happy to chance their arm in business for the freedom of life at sea. and there are always men to sail with them.
I'm a married man with two sons, a mortgage, a car, a budgie, a bird, a goat, a cow, a dog. I have a very ordinary home life. I really am just an ordinary seafarer, doing a job that I don't consider any more difficult than, say, a miner's job.
I've talked to lots of fishermen about it, and they think it's a holiday. They think you have such an easy life. Well, I've been fishing myself. I know it's hard, but they have their easy times as well. This job's just as hard as what theirs is. I mean, you go through the same kind of weather and things like that. You work odd hours, you work long hours.
If we wanted to know where we were going all the time, we'd go on a ferry. And then we didn't know exactly where we'd be at any hour of the day or night. We know exactly when we were going on leave. We'd all get more pay, and we'd all hate it. It's this sort of life where you think, well, goodbye, Wisbech. We've had 2 days here, and that's enough. A week later, we're going back to Wisbech. Oh, great, we can go in the so-and-so and see so-and-so. Yeah, smashing. And you're in there in the morning and out in the afternoon, and you don't see anyone at all. But you don't mind too much, because you were in Wisbech 2 weeks ago anyway.
And Wisbech it is, 11 miles inland. At 6:30 on a clear spring morning, the Carrick slips quietly up the River Neen from the Wash.
If you talk to somebody ashore, maybe, they'll say to you, what's the coast there? You have to say, I don't know, it's... You tell them that it's like Merchant Navy, but on a smaller scale. And some people, you say you go to these places that you go to, like Wisbech and places. They don't know there's a small port, they don't know there's a port there or anything like that. They just think it's a village or a town or something. But these ships can get into places that other ships can't.
The spuds come out. The dud cylinder is to be replaced. Tom goes on leave. At the moment, no one knows where the ship goes next. The mad March days slowly give way to summer, usually a quiet time on the coast. The cargoes change, the job goes on. A dirty British coaster making passages.
You might like to know that although the company went bust 2 months after this film was made, Rick Waters, the skipper, went back to sea again, and George Norman was mate on a small coaster which was one of the first to arrive at the scene of the Zeebrugge ferry disaster and was responsible for rescuing a number of passengers. Now look at this evening on Two. Our film at six once more follows in the footsteps of the super sleuth Gay Lawrence in A Date with the Falcon. Phil Silvers stars as Sergeant Bilko at 7:05, and then in the last of the current series, On the House, there's advice on barbecues, garden lighting and heating. There are regional